Good morning. I'll try that again. If you would please stand and join the singing forever. Give thanks to the Lord our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us. Forever, forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever and ever, forever. If you would, join me, love lifted me. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, billows his will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Now, if you would please join us in singing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
If you would please be seated.
Go to the Lord in prayer. We thank you, Father, that we have been made aware in as much as we are able to understand the amazing grace you have for us. And we confess to you that we are indeed amazed, that there is so much to your love and mercy that we just cannot begin to comprehend it all. And we pray that you will use this conviction of your mercies and grace to always keep our minds set on you. That when you tell us to rejoice always, regardless of the circumstances, we have cause for great rejoicing. Show us how indebted we are so that we can come to you as willing, as eager slaves to surrender everything we have to you, to enjoy that fellowship which comes only when we give up everything. Now we pray that you will strengthen your people who are here today to worship you, to praise your name, and to lift you up on high. That you will make our minds, our hearts, our wills one with yours. That we will indeed find the greatest joy when we praise you, the greatest fulfillment when we obey you, and the greatest fellowship as we walk with you in the assurance that you give us. Make your people strong, that we will be a good witness and bring honor and praise to Christ. We ask it in his name.
Singing, to God be the glory. To God be the glory, great things he had done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he had done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Don't mind to get wet. And right, Jonathan? Amen. Who's got children's church today? All right, Judy. Got the Judy and Annette sisters. You'll get into all kinds of things. You'll get taught something. I bet you'll be some artsy things there, and you'll enjoy that. Always be reminded, in just a few weeks, we'll be having Bible school. It's going to be in June this year, is that correct? And so I pray that you'll be ready when all of us come and try to encourage you and enlist you into that service. Bible school, for third of the kids that are presented Christ to will respond, and that's exciting. So I hope that you will invest time where God gives his greatest harvest. If you're here for the first time, we don't have any perforated sheet on the bulletin. Next Sunday, hopefully, we'll have a new bulletin. It's going to be upgraded a little bit. Got a little artwork on there that'll kind of pops out, and hopefully you'll enjoy it. But it'll get back to where we are, but so that you can fill out with some anonymity. But we'll have to do it the old-fashioned way today. And if you see somebody that you don't know, and I use this next term kind of with a little fear, if you see somebody that's strange, go up and grab a hold of them and talk to them, okay? And that will really bless their hearts and bless yours too. But Cedar Hill folk, get up and love somebody in the Lord. As everyone gets settled, today is Camp Galilee Day, and or Galilee Bible Camp, depending upon how old you are. But years ago, God gave to us a fellowship that has lasted the years, and we pray that we'll continue to do so, because we can go far beyond the walls of this church in our support and ministry out at Galilee Bible Camp. As we come together today, and Bill will be bringing the message, and we'll share other things, but we get an opportunity. And right now, our ushers, if they will come forward. This is our regular church offering, so I don't want to be confused, but at the end of the service, we're going to have an opportunity to invest in the ministry out at Camp Galilee, and so we'll talk to you more about that. But as they come forward, be reminded that as we give, God doesn't ask or what you have to give or what you don't have to give. As your hand is placed on the plate, all he asks is one thing: is my son the Lord of your life? And I hope and pray that that will be an easy question to answer.
Catch my breath for a minute. Please join us singing with us on Channels Only.
How
How I praise thee, precious Savior, that thy love laid hold of me, that filled me, that I might thy channel be. Channels only, blessed sister, but with all thy wandering through us, thou canst use us every day and every hour. Empty that thou shouldest fill me, a clean vessel in thy hand. There tell out thy full salvation.
Now I thought, how do we ever get so far down, and how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? Said I did, yeah. I created you. Now listen. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now. Well, it's time for us to do something. Say than to be, live like angels of apathy, who tell ourselves it's all right, somebody else will do something. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm sick and tired of life with no desire. I don't want a flame, I want a fire. I want to be the one who stands up and says, I'm gonna do something.
Maybe a little bit more contemporary than you're used to. But that's what our young people are listening to. That's probably one of the newest contemporary Christian songs out there by Matthew West. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. I'm going to do something a little bit different this morning. And you're going to have to interact with me on this one, because you have to do something, like the song said. I want to know how many of you that are here today were here back when Brother Ronnie came as your pastor. And if you were, would you stand? When he came as the pastor, I don't know, how many years ago was that? Almost 25 years ago. Look around. 25 years ago, Brother Ronnie and Kathy came. And I remember, you can sit down. Thank you. I remember when I came out here in January of 2004, and the very first time I walked into the doors of Cedar Hill Baptist Church, Miss Betty Glover, sitting back here, brought me in and took me into Carolyn Woodward's classroom, introduced me to the class, and after church that Sunday morning, Kevin and Joyce Kane and Betty Glover and Brother Ronnie and Kathy invited me to come down to their house, to the Arnold's house, for lunch. And I went down there and had lunch with them, and I thought, after I left, I thought, oh, what have I got myself into? Because, and it wasn't necessarily bad, but I was the new kid on the block. That was 10 years ago. And one of the questions that I got more than any other question when Brenda and I came here was, and maybe many of you could mimic this, that we're here when we came 10 years ago. They said, well, how long are you going to stay? Is that right? I got that more than any other question that I got when we came here. And when Brenda and I came in 2004, we really thought that we would be here at least 15 years. You know, we were 50 years old, 51 years old, and we thought the Lord had brought us here at that point to finish the ministry that our mission had called us to. At that time, they had a mandatory retirement age. Now, you can't do that anymore. That's against the law. You can't have a mandatory retirement age anymore. The HR would have a fit with that. But we knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that God had called us here for a purpose. And we felt like we knew what that purpose was. And about 2 years ago, God started working in our lives and really showed us that the purpose that He called us here for was being completed. And so in about a month and a half, we're going to finish, complete what God called us here to do. And we're going to talk a little bit about that this morning, but More than a completed work, what I want to talk to you about this morning is what this song talked about this morning and the history behind it. And I'll allude to that a little bit. But God calls us all to join Him in what He's doing, no matter where we are, whether it's Cedar Hill Baptist Church, whether it's Galilee Bible Camp out on Norris Lake, whether it's a Christian college. I know you support a missionary with CREW, Campus Crusade for Christ. Wherever that's at, God calls us all into some sort of relationship with Him where He wants to involve us in what He's doing in our world. And He does that here at Cedar Hill. He does it at Camp Galilee. He does it wherever it is. And 2 years ago, God started working and bringing a new team to Galilee Bible Camp. Now, many of you have met some of them, but I want to introduce at least part of that team. to you this morning, and I'm going to have them stand up. David and Stacy Bosch. They're going to be the new executive directors at Galilee Bible Camp starting on May the 3rd. That's the board meeting where I step down and they step in. And some people say, well, you can't do that. Well, you got to talk to God about that one, okay? And then Mark and Melissa Lay, and they are the new facilities managers at Galilee Bible Camp. And they're just like the rest of us. They have to raise their own support, and they're involved in that. And so anyway, they are going to be the new face. And then tonight, if you come back for the service tonight, when we share some slides about the camp, you're going to meet another portion of that team, and that's Adam and Becky Flady. And they are the program directors. And they're the ones that are kind of responsible for everything that goes on as far as programming at Galilee Bible Camp. When we think about how God draws people into Cedar Hill, or whether it's Galilee, or wherever it is, how many of you have ever gone across the White Bridge a couple of days after, or a day or so after, a big rain up in the mountains? Anybody ever driven across there? Okay, what do you see when you drive across the White Bridge in the lake? Okay, you see muddy water. You see sometimes, especially in the spring, sometimes you'll see lots of garbage, lots of trash, all kinds of things. And I really, I'm not sure why God put that in my mind this morning. I told Brenda when I got up, I thought I knew exactly what I was going to say. And then I said, well, God gave me this thought, and I think I need to share it. And I wasn't sure exactly why. And I thought, okay, Lord, I'm gonna listen to you, and I'm just going to share it. But you know what? Ministry sometimes is not very clean. It's not very sanitary. You may have people come into your youth group that you might not want your kids to associate with. Or you may have somebody come to church that needs you to just love on them, and they're not the people that you would want to associate with out in a normal everyday experience in life. Maybe they're not the person you want to just run around with. But God brings people into our midst, and He brings people to Cedar Hill, and He brings people to Camp Galilee that need God's love. They need us to be what that song was talking about. We need to be God's hands and His heart and His love, so that people, when they see us, they see a glimpse of who Jesus is. That song just touched me as I heard it, and to know the story behind it. 2 weeks ago, I was at a Wednesday night prayer meeting, and Brother Ronnie started talking about the book of Esther. And I told him last Wednesday, I said, man, you started to steal my thunder. So you got to quit doing that. Well, no, he can do whatever he wants. He's a pastor, right? Right. Well, he can't do whatever he wants. He's got to do what God tells him to do. But I want to ask you this. Most of you would say, and I'm not saying that this is going to happen, but if Brother Ronnie, and I just talked to Jeff Evans before he left, and a pastor of one of the churches just abruptly left their church, just announced one Sunday morning that I'm no longer the pastor, I'm gone. Well, if that were to happen here, and Brother Ronnie all of a sudden comes, stands behind the pulpit, and he says, this is my last Sunday, God's told me I need to go somewhere else. Most of us, and I would probably be the one included, would say nobody can be another Brother Ronnie Arnold. Would you agree with that? Do you agree with that? Yeah. I would agree with that too. But you know what? Nobody has to be another Ronnie Arnold. If God would tell him to go somewhere else, then he needs to do that. I'm not telling him to do that. But I'll get stuff thrown at me here in a minute. But the point I'm getting at, folks, is when God moves people and He brings other people in their place, they're never going to be the person that was there before. God didn't want them to be there. He didn't want them to be. So I'm saying that to tell you that many people have come to us and said, well, nobody can replace you, or nobody can be you. Well, I hope not. They don't need to be me. They need to be them. And the new families that have come to Galilee Bible Camp, they may do things differently than I did them. And that's okay, because that's the team God's brought here. And that's what a church needs to recognize whenever God removes a pastor or tells a pastor to go somewhere else. There's never going to be another person like them. They're unique. They're gifted in certain ways. Well, I want you to think about something from the book of Esther. Y'all know the book of Esther, the story behind the book of Esther. You know the name of God is never mentioned one time in the book of Esther? Not once. And I really thought about, you know, what a sense of humor God must have. Or what a sense of irony when you read books like the book of Esther. Because, you know, you have the whole story of Queen Vashti going in before the king, or not going in before the king when she's summoned, and the king banishes her and removes her from king. The search has gone out for a new queen. Esther is Jewish, which is not Persian, obviously. And she is chosen as the new king. And she goes in before the king unasked to save her people. And as you think about that, think about what was going on there. Do you think that Vashti, the king, the queen before Esther, was probably a beautiful queen? Yeah, more than likely. King Ahasuerus or Xerxes, both of those are the appropriate name for the king. In Esther, he's called Ahasuerus. In other places, he's called Xerxes, but the same person. He didn't have ugly queens. They sent a search out to find the queen, and Vashti was chosen first. Vashti refused to come in when invited by the king and was banished. Esther was chosen from among all the beautiful maidens that were brought before him to be the new queen. Now, I want to ask you a question about some questions about Esther. And when you think about her and think about all the things that were going on with the nation of Israel at that time, because they were in captivity, Ahasuerus, if you remember the story, before Esther went into the king, he had signed a decree that all the Jews could be killed. Haman got him to do that. And I don't know if you know this, but if you read the book, it says nothing that's signed by the Medes and the Persians can ever be retracted, can never be taken back. Once it's signed by the king, it's law. So Xerxes or Ahasuerus had already declared that all the Jews could be killed. All the land that they had, all the finances they had, everything that they had could be taken away from them by the person that killed them. And Haman was just having a heyday with that because he hated Mordecai, who refused to bow before Haman because Haman was second in command. And of course, the Jews would not bow before any man because they would only serve one God, and that was the Lord God, Jehovah. They would not bow before man. And Mordecai refused to bow before Haman, and Haman was incensed with rage. How dare this Jew refuse to bow before me? So he plotted this, cooked up this plot, got it signed by the king. Well, Esther was a Jew. So guess what? Anybody could kill Esther too, and the king couldn't really do anything about it. And Mordecai came into Esther and said, Esther, you need to go before the king. We need your help. What did Esther have to offer? Was it her beauty? Vashti was beautiful, so must not have been her beauty, even though that's what made her be chosen by, or at least from a human's perspective, that's what made her be chosen by the king. Was it her boldness? Because if it was, she wasn't very bold, because when Mordecai first asked her, she said, no, I can't do that. You go in before the king, and he doesn't extend his scepter, you're dead. So she wasn't going to go there. Was it her wisdom? Well, I believe she had a lot of wisdom in the way she handled the situation, but I don't believe that was her greatest ability or her greatest... Maybe it was just her willingness to be available to God. It wasn't her beauty. It wasn't her wisdom. It wasn't her boldness. It was just that when the opportunity came, Esther was willing to be used by God. And I think that same thing comes to all of us. There's a verse in Esther chapter 4, verse 14, and it says, For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, this is Mordecai speaking to Esther, think not with thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house more than all the Jews. For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their relief and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. Now, do you hear what he said? Esther, if you don't do this, then the deliverance will come from somewhere else. I want you to just hang on to that thought just a second. From another place, but thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. And here's the statement that I want you to grab a hold of. And it's a statement that we all need to wrestle with. And it is, and who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this? You get that? Who are you to say that you are not the one that's brought to the kingdom for just a time as this? And that same question could be asked of every one of us. What's so significant or so forceful about a statement like that? Because every one of us will answer it differently. Every one of us will. You could be asked to teach Vacation Bible School, and you go, well, I've never taught Vacation Bible School before. God didn't care if you've never taught Vacation Bible School before. He doesn't. If God calls you to teach, He'll equip you to do it. What about, God wants me to be involved in the bus ministry or the van ministry or drive the van or whatever, and you say, well, I can't do that. I've never done that before. I hate that answer. I've never done that before. You know, God doesn't care whether you've never done it before. If He calls you to do it, He'll equip you to do it. Whatever the job is, there's lots of things going on here at Cedar Hill. One of the things that I enjoyed, and I don't know where it's all gone, or whether it's being implemented or not, but for months, I remember coming in and looking at the board, the big board behind us, and on the screen, and noticing the ministries that the church was wanting to get people involved in. And it's been something on my heart, not necessarily for Cedar Hill, but for me, and I think something that God may use in the future in our lives, is what about a ministry of helps from the church? Are you a mechanic? Do you do lawn work? Can you paint? Can you do carpentry? Can you go to the grocery store for somebody? What about that? I don't know where it's gone. I don't know where that's going. But you know what? There are ways that all of us can be involved to be God's hands, to just do something. I want to tell you the story, and many of you may know the story behind that song. There was a young college student went to, I think it was Uganda, and I may have the country wrong, but I believe it was Uganda. And as she went to Uganda, she saw the plight of a group of orphans in an orphanage. And it's hard to even talk about this, but as she was there as this college student, on assignment there, I don't know if she was going to school or whether she was doing some kind of project or whatever, but she saw the plight of all these children in the orphanage there in Uganda. And she kind of, like Matthew West said, she shook her fist at God and said, God, why don't you do something? These kids are dying. They're being abused. They're not being fed. You know, why don't you do something? And as it said in the song, she said, God spoke as clearly as I'm speaking to you. I did do something. I created you. What are you going to do? And see, folks, that's the same way with us. That's the same question He asks us, when we see needs in our community, or we see needs in our church, or we see something that is just, you know, a social injustice, or whatever it might be, and we respond with, God, why don't you do something? And he says the same thing to us. I did. I created you. What are you going to do about it? What are you going to do? And that's so important for us to ask ourselves that question. You know, God didn't call us to sit in those seats and just attend Sunday morning or Sunday night or Wednesday night. He called us to get involved in what he's doing in our world. And folks, he can use every one of us. It doesn't matter who you are, what your gifts are, what your talents are, what they are. God can use all of us. There's another song written by Jason Gray. And you can tell I listen to contemporary Christian music. These guys I'm talking about, 60 years old, and I get involved in all this young people's music, I guess. But, we all had our music, I guess, when we were growing up. You know, I grew up in the 60s and 70s, and we didn't have this good stuff. We had Kumbaya and stuff like that, which is good. It's okay, but it's not like what we have today. And some of the stuff we had today I think is kind of fluffy. You know, just there's a lot of air to it, but not a lot of substance. But some of these songs that we have today, you know, are just so pointed. And Jason Day wrote a song called Every Act of Love. And one of the set of lyrics in that song says, God made a million, million doors in this world for his love to walk through. One of those doors is you, is me. So how can we show the love of Jesus Christ to the world that we live in? Well, I don't have that answer for you. I only have that answer for me. And the question that God asks each one of us is, are you going to leave that door open to let his love walk through? Are you going to be his heart and his hands and his feet in our world to meet the needs that are around you? And folks, you know, it doesn't take money. Although ministry takes money. That's not what I'm talking about here. It takes availability, just like Esther. If Esther hadn't have been the one that went before the king and extended the scepter, somebody else would have. Because God accomplishes his plan. And what happens in our lives so many times is we miss the blessing of God on our life because we just don't say yes when he calls. And that's all he wants is a yes from us. And he'll make a way to get the yes accomplished, whatever that is. So, are you one of those million, million doors that God made? Yeah. Are you going to let his love walk through you? I hope you do. Pray that you do. One of the things that Brother Ronnie says when he gives an invitation is, you know what God wants you to do. You knew it before you came in this building this morning. I don't know why God changed some of those things that I was going to talk about this morning or share with you, but I want to leave you back with that verse out of Esther chapter 4. And who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this. Esther went, saved the whole nation of Israel from annihilation. Not only saved them from annihilation, there was another decree written that the Jews could go and attack anybody that was going to attack them and take everything that they had if they wanted to. I don't think God's going to do that necessarily for us today. I don't think that's what he's talking about there. But when you read the book of Esther, you see the irony of the world thinks that they've got the church defeated. Well, I don't know about you, but I read the book at the end of the Revelation, and it tells me that we're the overcomers, not the world. You know, greater is he that lives within us than he that's in the world. And folks, if you know Jesus as your Savior, you know him as your personal Lord and Savior, the gates of hell, you can attack them with a squirt gun and be victorious. God is the victor. And that's what Haman didn't understand. You remember what happened to Haman? Haman built a gallows, I think 50, 75 feet tall, to hang Mordecai on. You know what happened to Haman? He got hung on his own gallows. God is in control in this world, whether it looks like it or not. And he made us part of that, and he just asked us to be that conduit to let his blessing flow out into our world. What has he called you to do? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your love for us. And Father, you know, as I think about the ways that you've called us as your people to be a part of what you're doing in our world, it's just it's amazing that you use us. Because we have, you know, in ourselves, we have very little to offer you. But Father, you can empower us to be whatever you want us to be in your world.